In that case, I think we can let everyone in.
Good song choice there.
You're welcome.
Oh, I've just seen there's a problem with the link. Radhika, if you can let me know which link, there was an issue. Oh, the one in the email and on Humanetics. Okay.
I'll
Thanks for letting
that.
Us know. Cool. Awesome.
Might just wait 4 minutes for me to send that out again.
Mm-hmm. No worries.
It redirects to Slack.
Oh my God. That's the worst.
So I'm just going to post this in the chat again in case people haven't seen it in the waiting room. And just to let everyone know, we'll be starting in a minute. So in the meantime, you're welcome to just have a look at the resources I'm popping into the chat. Okay, so we've got a few more people coming in, and I think in a little bit, Sarah, we might get into it.
Okay, that fixed link was just sent out to everyone, so hopefully it'll come in the next 5 minutes.
Okay, thank you, Eliza. Okay, thanks, Sarah. Well, I think for the meantime, we might get into it. So, Mayong Hapon, and welcome everyone to this international event, The Neuroscience Behind Depression. So a quick reminder to everyone to please keep your microphones and cameras off just so we can move through the event smoothly. Before proceeding, I would like to begin with an acknowledgement to country. This is a gesture of reconciliation with the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people who have been the rightful owners of Australia for over 60,000 years. So on behalf of each of us in Australia tonight, I acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land. For myself in Melbourne, it is the Wurundjeri people of the Kulin Nations. I pay my respects to their elders past, present and emerging. Thank you. Okay, so firstly, we have an important message from the Department of Education in the Philippines, who are a partner of our health education program in Bukidnon. Unfortunately, our designated speaker is unable to join us tonight due to a COVID-19 positive case in their building, which has meant they needed to quarantine. And we send our best wishes as the department is working hard to combat this, but they are faced with a tough process due to the lack of an automated contact tracing system. So one of our roles at Halad to Health has been to support our partner community in Valencia City. And it has been through donations that we have been able to send them much needed PPE, such as masks and gowns, not only, but especially during this time. So thank you for your participation in our event, as every bit of support truly does make a difference. In regards to our section on statistics of depression in the Philippines, we will try to make this recording available on our Halad to Health Philippines Facebook page next Tuesday at 8 p.m. Australian Eastern Standard Time. Okay, so my name is Emma and I'm an operations team member at Halad to Health Australia. If you're not joining us from the Philippines, you might be wondering what Halad means. So Halad means an offering in the Bisayan language. So we choose to offer the opportunity to good health. We are an international charity closing the gap in global health inequality through delivering free health education services in the rural Philippines. And this is fully funded by our GAMSAT and Med Interview Services, which help students get into postgrad medicine. So any donations from events like tonight go straight to the cause. So thank you so much for coming together to learn and make a difference with us. We are incredibly lucky to have two wonderful speakers tonight. So we have Francis from Halad to Health, who hopefully will be able to join us live from Bukidnon, Philippines, and also our keynote speaker, Dr. Elena Pozzi from the Melbourne Neuropsychiatry Centre. So we do have an updated agenda for tonight. Following a short introduction to the topic, we will talk with Francis about what depression looks like and feels like through the eyes of a Filipino teenager. Then Dr. Elena Pozzi will explore the neuroscience behind what depression actually is and why it occurs. At the end, we'll have about 10 to 15 minutes for questions. So please post any questions you have in the chat during the presentation and we'll aim to answer them as many as we can. We also have Charity tonight who will be moderating our chat and she can also translate your questions if you're more comfortable posting them in Bisaya. Okay, so our aims for the event tonight are definitely to help empower young people, no matter their background, with a better understanding of their mental health and also the scientific background of depression. So to help, in addition, to help reduce the stigma associated with depression and to create an open discussion about mental health and seeking help if we need. So because of this, we will be discussing some sensitive topics, including depression and suicide. If at any point you are feeling uncomfortable, please feel free to take a moment to pause. We will also be sending out more important resources for mental health support at the end of the event. So, how many people suffer from depression? According to the World Health Organization, more than 264 million people around the world. In Australia, that's 1.3 million people, and with one of the highest rates of depression in Southeast Asia, the Philippines totals 3.3 million Pinoys suffering from depression. Young people aged between 15 and 29 years of age are most at risk, and at its worst, depression can lead to suicide, and is the second leading cause of death among this age group. This is a devastating reality. For a lot of our Australian audience, it might be the first time we hear about the reality of mental health in a cultural context very different from ours. So we encourage everyone to keep an open mind and to consider what the similarities and differences might be. So at this stage, I believe Francis is unable to join us in the live. I'll just confirm that with Eliza, if that is the case.
Yep, he is just struggling with internet right now, sorry.
That's okay. So, which is of course very unfortunate because Francis is very, and has been very keen to join this event and share his personal perspective and wanted to be able to do this live. However, we did foresee some internet issues due to an outage in the area where he lives. And so we have prepared a pre-recording of a discussion between myself and Francis. And so I'll still give an introduction to Francis. So he is currently studying arts and political science at Central Mindanao University in Bukidnon and has been a student ambassador for Halad to Health Philippines since his final year at Valencia City National High School. He will share some of his own insight into what teenagers in Bukidnon might know about depression and how they might manage it. So for now, we'll have a look at the video and hopefully, fingers crossed, he'll be able to join us for the Q&A a bit later.
So firstly, Francis, what do you know about the issue of depression among youth in Bukidnon?
Depression is actually a well-known word here in Bukidnon at the EMA. We use depression in our daily conversations. However, we often feel stressed and the hard thing is that we don't know or where to go to. As a result, we just keep it to ourselves and handle it silently. Mm. And fighting it silently is a really hard thing, especially if a lot of things is coming on your way, like you don't know what to do first. So I hope other youths is not experiencing what I have experienced in the past. So that's why I'm really, really fighting for this cause.
Absolutely. And I think it can be quite scary and isolating to be, you know, struggling with something like depression and feeling like you don't know who to run to. So that's something we'd like to talk about a bit more. You did mention that in the Philippines, people use the word depression in their conversation. So when people use the word depression around you, do you think they truly understand what it is or what it means?
Yeah, actually, I think they only knew depression by definition and they don't have the full context of what depression is, what's the cause of depression, or what is the effects of depression. And also young people here in Bukidnon usually hide what we truly feel behind our smiles, but to deep inside it's really heavy and we feel like we're drowning on a big ocean. We silently plea for help, but we usually don't know or find anyone to talk, which results some of the teenagers is ending their lives.
So that's a pretty devastating reality to hear, Francis. And so when you mentioned that, you know, young people might not know who to turn to, what about family and friends? If someone's experiencing depression, how might a family member or friend help that person?
So a family usually do when someone is depressed is that a family member would try to persuade that person to share what's happening or call a relative to consult and decide on what to do next. So as a friend, we're doing what we want or we both like or things that she or he enjoys the most. Mm. And after that, I'm going to try to talk to her to her or to him to tell me what's happening so that I could know or help her more. Mm. But the sad reality is that people would also talk behind our backs and spread rumors like a wildfire. They start calling us crazy, which makes it so hard to face the rest of the society. Mm. I guess the society works like this. And it's really disappointing because instead of helping those who wants help, they are pushing it like it's unimportant.
Mm. And that's definitely a problem because if people are spreading rumors, if they're, you know, calling you crazy for having mental ill health or experiencing depression, then that's, yeah, really not supportive for that person. Why do you think society turns its back on people who are experiencing depression?
Based on my observation at the EMA, society turns it backs because they don't have a context on what's happening. Because they believe that if you are depressed, then you are crazy. And if you are crazy, then you might hurt other people. So actually, I also think that spreading rumors is actually, it's like either defense mechanism. so that other people would keep its distance from other person, after that person, I mean.
Okay, so Francis, do you think there might be more young people experiencing depression or mental health issues due to COVID?
Adema, in our current situation, yes, I do believe depression is slowly getting normal without us noticing it. This may be due to our new way of learning, which is having online classes. Actually, I'm not definitely generalizing all schools and universities, but from my experience, I can truly say that facing our laptops and cell phones all day can be quite detrimental. We sit on our desk and do activities and quizzes all day because we have 9 subjects, and most of that subjects usually would give too long activities that we would have to finish in a week and pass it on the next week. Mm-hmm. And the sad thing actually at the EMA is that Filipino parents is really a competitive, like, I'm not generalizing all parents, but most of my classmates, their parents is very strict when it comes to grade. Like, they want their child to be on top every time. They want their child to be on the top 10, to be the first, in which it added more pressure to the kid, because being on top is really difficult. You need to, in a quiz, you need to have one mistake or two. In a periodical exam, you have to always get the passing score, which makes you need to study late at night. And sleeping late and waking up early is not good for health.
Yeah, absolutely. And everything that you've just mentioned, that's a lot of added pressure. And I think for young people now, there are all these added stresses to consider. You know, not only is it being able to do your school subjects where, you know, usually you have your friends and you've got face-to-face classes with a teacher, but kind of in an isolated environment and trying to deal with that all on your own, that can definitely stack up. And I think even, you know, for myself, I've definitely felt times where I've felt a little bit anxious and overwhelmed as well. And so, Francis, for yourself personally, how have you felt dealing with those pressures and studying from home?
It's actually very difficult because when you are at home, you don't have the urge to study. Actually, like, if you're at home, you just want to watch some TVs, watch some movies with your family, spend with your time with your nephew, and you may end up forgetting your task. And it can also conflict with the household chores, like, you need to wash these dishes, you need to clean the house, and then after that you feel tired. And when you remember you have to pass an assignment the next day or today, even though if your body is not capable of doing it, you need to force it.
But I think you're right in that now there's a lot more time management pressure on students. Because you have to divide, you know, all the subjects and the tasks that you have to complete in your own time. And I think that is quite difficult. And so, yeah, thank you for kind of sharing a little bit more about that context. Just to bring it back to the severity of the issue of depression, do you know anyone who has experienced depression or even has committed suicide?
So back when I was in high school, I recall cases wherein students from our school committed suicide during my 4 years in high school. Throughout these years, there were 3 students who ended their lives, not including the 7th grader who committed suicide last January. It's really devastating to hear things like this. If only we could have more access to handle mental issues, then lesser lives could be lost. The youth are the hope of our nation, and we should be more aware of this growing problem in our society to be truly become the hope that everyone believes us to be.
Yeah, thank you for sharing that, Francis. And it is truly saddening to hear that. And I think this is the problem that we're dealing with, and it's a very serious problem. And I think especially when we can imagine that things might be different, if there are more support systems available for young people who are struggling with a lot of these stresses and pressures as well. So do you know of any support systems or mental health organizations that are available in Bukidnon?
Yeah, actually at Emma, this is really the hard thing here in our place, because there are no organization or facilities to cater these kind of problems in our area. That's the problem, because we are really don't know, or we are not more aware if there are programs for mental health in Bukidnon. This issue has been gradually looming over the minds of the youth here in Bukidnon. And people are turning a blind eye or just don't care, because it's not, because they think it's not a really big problem to provide some solutions. But because they cannot see it directly from the youth, because as I mentioned earlier, we hide these problems behind our smile. So when they say these youths enjoy every day, they're doing parties, going to birthdays, so they think that mental issue is not a thing. That's why they're not providing some solutions.
Yeah, and it can be something that is overlooked, because I think there is this idea that you can't see depression, so you know, oh, it's not happening. But that's probably, you know, the farthest thing from the truth. Okay, so Francis, I know this is something we've spoken about before between the two of us. But if you are happy to share, what might it feel like to experience depression?
So Atema, based on my experience, depression is like when you are in a box, a container, and you are trapped, you don't know where how to get out. Depression is the water flowing under below you. As you go on, like keeping it to yourselves, like letting it bite you, like denying that you are having a hard time, the water increases bigger and bigger until it lapses, it overpasses you, and you start drowning. So we all know how it feels to be drowned, like when you're grasping for air but you cannot find some air because you are in a container. So that's really hard, like you wanted to die in the same time you want to live.
Okay, thanks for sharing that, Francis, because that's a pretty vivid image, I think, and definitely, you know, being trapped and then not feeling, perhaps feeling like there's a barrier between yourself and others. And so being able to reach out can actually be quite difficult, even if, you know, you know that it might help you when you are kind of trapped in that box. So how do you think, you know, you can manage those feelings? How can you kind of break down that box?
For me, I talk to my friends, like ask for help, what to do. So if I'm going to put this on the back scenario, they're going to bring some hammer to smash down the container so that I could get out on that container.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's kind of, in a way, I guess, setting you free. And it might not be that simple. It might be, you know, a longer journey with that, but it is, yeah, absolutely. It's important to have a support network to help you through. So how do you think young people can manage their feelings instead with what they do have available?
So me personally, at Emma, usually due to joining youth organizations to vent out and find some people I could trust, share my problems or to share what I feel right now. And some of people is really passionate or a good listener. I feel comfortable talking to them.
Well, so do you think youth organizations can help to support people who might be struggling with mental health issues?
Actually, I think it depends on the person who's training, because for me, it really helped me to ventilate, to forget my problems, because I enjoy talking to different people, socializing to different people. In that way, I could forget what's happening to me and think about it and later ask other people for help. But some people also managing stress or depression by music, singing,
yeah,
dancing, or drawing. And actually, youth organization can also cause stress, especially if there's tasks given to you and you don't know what to do or how to do that task. So that's why I said that it depends on the person who's joining.
Yeah, of course. And I think that it just raises the importance of, you know, different things work for different people. And it's kind of about exploring what does work for you and whether that's working on mindfulness, whether it's finding, you know, a therapeutic form of art or exercise. You know, there's a lot of things that definitely can help. So finally, Frances, what information or services do you think, you know, should be available to young people in Bukidnon?
So actually, watching movies from other countries give me this idea. I would like to have a support group to support these people. Mm-hmm. In that group, they would discuss, they will tell what they feel, what they are experiencing. And in that group, it's not like all this depressed is in one group. There is a professional handling them. After they share what they feel or what they're having right now, that professional will give them some tip or guide them how to win the battle. And after they, for example, there's a person who successfully beat depression, and we're going to run another program in which they will go, we will give a school by school symposium in which that person who survived depression will talk in front of these kids, because there is a different vibe when someone talks because he know what is depression than someone who's talking because he beat depression. He could give more tips how to handle it. He could touch more hearts. In that way, the people who's trying to hide it would have the urge or the confidence to go to that focus group and join and tell what he or she's having right now.
Yeah, for sure. And I think if someone has lived experience of something such as depression or other mental health issues, then it can be quite empowering for other people to realize that, you know, it's something you can manage and there's support out there. And it's really important to talk about as well. So thank you for sharing all of that, Frances. Just, is there anything else you'd like to share with the audience?
Okay, before my part ends, I want the audience to know that depression is not a joke. And if you're having depression, you could beat it by, for say, ask help for your friends, what to do, or talk to them. So it depends, like I said before, it depends on person how to cope up or how to defeat it. And I want also to let other people that depression is different from being crazy. Depression is way more deep than you think. And to all watching this, suicide is not a solution for depression. Just think, if you committed suicide, maybe you're thinking, if I commit suicide, my problem will be solved. But actually, you just added more problems to your family. The teachers also told us every time we're doing something, think before you act, because maybe if you think carefully, if you only think something a couple of times, think it over like 100. When you think 100 of times, think over 1,000 until you're really sure of doing something. This way, we can ensure that is the right thing and that's not the wrong thing.
And I think definitely the take-home message you have there is to be able to talk about it and not hold it in, because by doing that can be a way of, I guess, breaking down that box that you talked about before, and that you will find ways to manage or cope with how you're feeling. So Frances, thank you very much for joining me and talking about a pretty personal and sensitive topic, and I think it will help a lot of people. So thank you.
Thank you. and get them. Thank you guys.
Okay, so that was Francis, and you can see how passionate he is about this topic. And so we truly appreciate him taking the time. We actually did record that video earlier because we thought we might have some internet issues. But Francis, you know, puts in a lot of his extra time to be able to spread that message. So a big thank you to Francis. Okay, so now I would like to introduce our keynote speaker for tonight. Dr. Elena Pozzi recently completed her PhD at the University of Melbourne, where she is now working as a postdoctoral research fellow. Her research focuses on the relationship between childhood experiences, brain development, and mental health. In particular, she hopes to understand early risk factors for depression that can be targeted with prevention strategies, and to share her research with young people and the community. So just a reminder, if you do have any questions for Dr. Pozzi, to please post them in the chat and we'll be able to answer them in the Q&A a bit later. So I'll pass it over to you, Elena. So might just need to unmute first, and then you're welcome to take it away. So we'll spend, maybe just another minute to check everything is working. And let me know if you do need any assistance with getting the slides up. So Elena, maybe if you can unmute first and then you can let us know if something might not be working. Right, so maybe if
sorry about that. Let's see. Issue of having two screens. Okay. Thank you.
So yeah, let's maybe just try that again. See if it can go back to sharing. Fantastic. Yes.
Sorry about that.
Worries at all.
Yeah, thank you very much for having me here. I'm a researcher at the University of Melbourne, and today we'll be talking about some neuroscience research behind depression. So I'm originally from Italy, actually, and I moved to Melbourne in 2015 to do my postgraduate research degree, so PhD. And this is a picture of Melbourne. Melbourne is quite beautiful. It's famous for its street art and the beautiful nature close to the city. After I completed my degree last year, I continued working at the University of Melbourne as a research fellow. And this is a picture of the building where our lab is. The research center is on the third floor, and it's called Melbourne Neuropsychiatry Center. It's a large open space that is shared by students and staff members. However, like many others, since the beginning of the COVID-19 pandemic, I've been working from home. So since March, my office looks a bit different. And my main coworker is our cat, who loves sitting on my notebook. And we also have a dog, but she mostly sleeps while we're working. Today, I hope to answer a few questions around mental health and depression. So we start defining what is neuroscience and some of the techniques that neuroscientists use, particularly magnetic resonance imaging or MRI. Then I will move on to what is depression and why some individuals develop it, and what we know about changes occurring in the brain. I will also discuss some strategies that we can use to keep our mind healthy, and options that are available if you have concerns about depression for yourself or someone else. And I want to take the opportunity here to remind you that I will be discussing some sensitive topics that can be distressing for some people. So for example, symptoms of depression. So if at any point you feel that you need a break, please feel free to turn off your volume. And of course, reach out in the chat with any questions and comments. So what is neuroscience? Neuroscience is a multidisciplinary science that investigates the structure and the function of the nervous system. And the central nervous system includes the brain and the spinal cord. Today, I will focus on the brain. And neuroscience is a multidisciplinary subject. So it means that it combines elements of different subjects, such as biology and physiology, but also computer science and psychology, to understand how brain cells, neurons, communicate with each other to form complex behavior. So for example, playing tennis or feeling happy or sad. Because it's a multidisciplinary subject, neuroscientists use different techniques. One of the main distinctions is that some neuroscientists study animal behavior, like cat, and while others, like me, study humans. When we study the brain in a living organism, we have to use special techniques. And with humans, these techniques are non-invasive, meaning that we can study the brain safely without causing harm to the person. And this image represents a child undergoing a brain scan, which I will describe in the next slide. Before talking about what is MRI and how it works, an important distinction to make is about what actually makes up the brain. So the image shows what you would see if you were to look at halfway through the brain from the top of the head. So in the brain, we have gray matter and white matter. Gray matter is mainly made of neurons, so the brain cells. White matter instead is made of nerve fibers, which are called axons. And these transport communication between neurons. So you can think of the gray matter as like cities in your brain, and white matter are like the roads that connect them. And magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, allows us to see inside the human body by using magnets and radio waves. The first MRI scanner was built in New York in 1977, and since then the technology has made a lot of progress, and the image we can obtain a much better resolution. And the MRI is different from the X-ray because it doesn't use radiation, so it's safe to use. And the MRI is basically a giant magnet. It's about, I think, 60,000 times the Hertz magnetic field. And it uses magnetic fields and radio waves to map the location and quantity of the water in our body, and then uses this information to generate a detailed image like this one. In particular, use the hydrogen atoms that are in the water molecules to get a signal from the body during the scan. And this is possible because when the hydrogen nuclei are placed in the MRI scanner, their axes realign with the scanner magnetic field. And when they flip back, they give off energy. And different tissues in the body, so the gray matter and white matter, other tissues, give off different amount of energy. And this is how we are able to differentiate between them. And a coil placed around the head in the scanner acts as an antenna that detects the release energy as an electric current, and then it converts it into an image like the one we see. And when we talk about images in the brain, we don't distinguish just between gray matter and white matter, but also structure and function of the brain. So when we look at the structure of the gray matter, so like the picture on the left, we look at things like the volume of different regions or how thick is the cortex. For white matter, which is the image coming up now, we instead look at the integrity of the nerve fibers. And functional MRI instead allows us to see how different regions activate in response to a particular task that a participant is doing in the scanner. When brain cells are active, they consume oxygen, and this changes the blood flow and the oxygenation in the brain. So we are able to detect this with the MRI scanner. So to give you a practical example, if we want to study what happens in the brain when we are processing emotions, a very typical functional MRI experiment is to show people a picture of emotional faces, like this one, when they're lying in the scanner, and then we see which area lights up, so which area activate in response to that emotion. Now, before defining what is depression, I will define what is mental health. So mental health is defined by the World Health Organization as a state of well-being in which every individual realizes their own potential, can cope with the normal stresses of life, can work productively and make a contribution to their community. Mental health disorder instead cause disruption in the personal life. So for example, the person might stop hanging out with friends or start having trouble studying or working. Depression is a mood disorder defined in the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Health Disorder, or DSM. We currently don't have a tool to make diagnosis of depression, so we don't have a thermometer, for example, like we have for fever. So the symptoms, so the diagnosis is made by a mental health specialist. So for example, a psychiatrist who is a doctor specialized in mental health, by observing signs and symptoms in the person. And to meet criteria for a diagnosis of depression, the DSM says that the individual must be experiencing 5 or more symptoms for the same 2 weeks period. And at least one of the symptoms should be depressed mood or loss of interest or pleasure. I will now describe some of the symptoms and try to give some practical examples. And again, please feel free to turn off the volume and take a break at any time if you need. One of the main symptoms is feeling sad and unhappy for most of the day, nearly every day for at least 2 weeks. Some people might describe this feeling as emptiness or numbness. Young people might feel not just sad, might also feel a little more irritable and have anger outbursts for no apparent reason or more than usual. So the person might feel overly stressed, worried down, or cry for no apparent reason. Another important symptom is the loss of interest and pleasure in activities that were previously enjoyed. So warning signs include a person that stops going out, starts avoiding social contact, stops spending time with family and friends. The person might also experience a significant change in appetite or weight. So some people lose weight even when they're not trying to diet, or some people might eat more and gain more weight. The person might have also trouble sleeping. It could mean both insomnia, so for example, difficulty falling asleep or waking up in the middle of the night or very early in the morning, or hypersomnia, so having trouble getting out of bed. The person might also feel tired, fatigue more than usual, and have trouble concentrating, difficulty making decisions, and have trouble with memory. So this might start by having trouble getting things done at school or at work. And importantly, the person might feel bad, might feel hopeless, guilty, and generally be very self-critical and self-blaming, and be preoccupied with dark and gloomy themes and thoughts of death or suicide. So warning signs to watch out for are phrases like, I'm a failure, it's my fault, what's the point, I can't take this anymore. And young people experience depression like adults do, very similarly. However, they might experience more mood swings, more anger outbursts. So sometimes it can be harder for them to get help because people think they're just teenager problems. Anyone can develop depression. However, we see that during adolescence and early adulthood, there is a peak in the onset of depression, so the peak beginning of depression. And in Australia, 1 in 6 young people will experience depression, and females are up to 3 times more at risk than males. And the World Health Organization estimates that depression affects more than 300 million individuals worldwide, so in every country. Do we know what is the cause of depression? And the short answer is not really. We think that there is not a single cause, but rather is a combination of factors. And some of these are genetic. So according to estimates, genetic factors account for about 30 to 40% of depression. For example, having a family member with depression is a risk factor. Early experiences are also really important, and in particular, negative experiences such as childhood trauma have been linked to increased risk of developing depression. And early experiences also interact with genetic factors, and other things that play a role are personality traits, coping style, physical illness, and other events that might occur during an individual lifetime. It is important to note that having a risk factor doesn't necessarily mean that the person will develop depression. So this means that two people exposed to the same experience might have a very different outcome. And this is we think that this is because genetic and environmental factors interact, and some people might be more sensitive or resilient than others. So this picture represents this idea of different sensitivity or susceptibility in people using turtles and tortoises. They look similar, but biologically they are very different. So in the example, the turtle, I hope I don't get them mixed up, the turtle is more resilient. So the one on the orange line. So meaning that for them, it doesn't really matter in which the environment they're placed in, they would do pretty okay either way. But the tortoise instead is more sensitive. So it will do not very well if it's placed in the water, but it will thrive even more than the turtle in the land. It's possible that people exposed to the same environment will have a different outcome depending on their level of sensitivity, and which we think that this sensitivity is determined by biological, genetic, and other environmental factors. So going back to our question, we can see that understanding the causes of depression is quite complicated. I come from a developmental perspective, so I wanted to briefly touch on how early experiences get under the skin, where I mean have an effect on our brain. And the image you see is a time-lapse imaging, show brain maturation from age 5 to 20 into just a few seconds. And red indicates more gray matters and blue less gray matter. The gray matter decline with age as the brain mature, and this is because with development, neural correlations are pruned. It's a bit like with a tree. So if you imagine a tree growing, as a tree grows, the stronger branches keep growing, while the weaker ones might be trimmed. In brain perspective, the stronger branches are the ones that we use the most. So when two brain cells activate together frequently, the connection between them becomes stronger and more efficient. In contrast, when two cells activate together infrequently, the connection becomes weaker and it is likely to be eliminated. And the principle is use it or lose it. So this is where early experiences play an important role, as which connection are strength will depend on the experiences a young person does. And importantly, different areas in the brain develop differently. So areas performing more basic function mature early in an individual life, while areas for higher order functions mature later. And I will explain this in the next slide. The fact that different areas in the brain have a different timing of development might explain why young people are more at risk of developing depression. So the blue line here represents the development of what we call higher order regions, in particular the prefrontal cortex, which is the part of the brain circle in blue. So the higher order function refer to cognitive processes such as making decisions, planning, and regulating emotion. The development of this cognitive control system developed slowly over time until late 20s. And if we think to when we were children, we were not able to make plans, for example, to organize a holiday. It's something we kind of learned to do later. And then there are regions dedicated to more basic functions, such as processing threat and dangerous things and emotion in general. Such abilities are essential to survival and therefore they develop quicker. We will call this the emotion processing system. And the amygdala, circle in red, is a very important region for emotion processing. And some evidence suggests that there is a temporal mismatch between the control and the emotion processing system during adolescence, which is the age between 10 to 18. So that the brain is very quick to respond to emotional stimuli, but not so much in regulating their response. So this means as we grow older, our brain gains different abilities in regulating our feelings. So for example, if we have a fight with our parents, maybe when we were children, we start crying. Then we, maybe when we are adolescents, we don't cry anymore, we leave the room angry. But then as we become adults, maybe we stay and try to find a way to diffuse the situation. So we kind of gain different skills in terms of emotional regulation. And it's possible there's this mismatch between emotional response and cognitive control during adolescence increase the risk of emotion dysregulation, especially in a period of demands for regulation, because during adolescence there are many changes in social and affective relationships. And this is very relevant for depression because depression, as we've seen, is characterized by emotional disturbances, so negative mood and irritability. And stress during development, as well as later in life, has also important implication for the brain. When we are exposed to stressful events, which could include any event that causes an alteration to our internal equilibrium, our brain responds by producing stress hormones, such as cortisol, which is produced by the adrenal gland. And this generates a cascade of events that include effect on the immune system to get your body ready to fight or escape the stress. This response on the short term is a function to get you through the stressful situation and help you restoring an internal equilibrium in your body. So it's an adaptive response. However, prolonged exposure to stress is thought to be harmful. For the brain in particular, we think that prolonged exposure to stress hormones can be toxic and cause alterations in some regions, particularly the ones that are more involved in these systems, which are the amygdala, which is the one that perceives the threat, the prefrontal cortex that analyzes the situation, and the hippocampus, which is the region that retrieves memories about other situations and makes new memory. And we think that there is a biological link between depression and between stress and depression, because the same regions, because the same regions are the ones that show alteration in depression. And indeed, the amygdala, hippocampus, and prefrontal cortex are among the regions that have been most consistently found to be altered in terms of function and structures in depression. As I mentioned before, the amygdala responds to emotional stimuli. So to give you a practical example, you're walking on a hiking track and suddenly you see a snake. Your amygdala will respond quickly and will tell you danger, and generate a cascade of events so that your body is ready to run away or fight the snake. But then your prefrontal cortex, which is your control system, will come in, analyze the situation, retrieve information from the hippocampus, which is your memory system, and tell you, actually, that is not a snake, it's just a rope, don't worry. Some research has found that in depression, amygdala is hyperactive, so very responsive to negative stimuli, and the prefrontal cortex is not really doing a great job in controlling its activity. And this might explain why people with depression have difficulties operating cognitive control over negative feelings. And the hippocampus, on the other hand, contributes to the regulation of stress response. And it plays a role in forming emotional memories and therefore can influence amygdala response to emotional stimuli. And alteration in hippocampal volume are quite a robust finding in depression. And I think there was a question about memory deficit in depression. And some research indeed suggested alteration in the hippocampus underlie memory deficits that we see in individuals with depressions. And this is combined with an increased attention to a negative stimuli, which is called cognitive bias. So people tend to kind of focus more on negative things. And so this is likely to bias the recollection of memories. And some research has also found that the chemicals that the brain used to communicate with each other, which are called neurotransmitters, are possibly reduced in depression. And this is one of the mechanisms through which antidepressant medication work for some people, as they restore the level of neurotransmitters, particularly serotonin. So the short answer to the question, is depression a brain disorder, is we think yes. However, we don't have evidence there is a single region that is responsible or that is different in depression, because depression is a complicated disorder and so seems to be the alteration in the brain underlying it. Indeed, not all the studies have found the same results, and so we still have most hypotheses. So to try to have a clearer picture, in more recent year, neuroscientists have moved from the investigation of single regions, such as the amygdala, to the investigation of networks. So regions that activate together during a particular task. And this is because regions don't operate in isolation. So researchers started to think, oh, maybe we should try to look at the interaction between all these regions. So the figure on the right show the so-called default mode network, which is a network of region that activates when people are basically daydreaming. So if you are not doing anything in particular, you're just kind of letting your mind wander. We can do that in the scanner. So we ask people to just lie down, usually just either with their eyes closed or looking at a black screen and kind of letting their mind wander. And we see this network that kind of consistently activate in everyone, kind of reflects thinking. So we think some evidence suggests that in depression, this network is not functioning properly. And this might relate to the continuous negative thinking that is called rumination that we see in depression. And currently, researchers are trying to undertake an even broader investigation. So I look at the connectivity between all regions across the whole brain. So this is called whole brain functional connectivity or structural connectivity. And ultimately, we hope to that an understanding of the biological characteristic of depression will help developing better treatment and identifying people at risk. And this picture just shows an overview from a recent scientific paper that summarized results from different studies of network connectivity. A and B refer to functional MRI and C and D to structural MRI, so the structure and the function of the brain. So I won't go into details, but the point is that across different modalities, so across structure and function of the brain, we see alteration in regions and networks underlying depression, particularly those networks involved in emotion processing, emotion regulation, feeling of reward and pleasure. And you might recall at the beginning, I say that we don't have a tool to make a diagnosis of depression yet. The diagnosis is based on symptoms, and sometimes these symptoms can be opposite. So maybe you remember that I say that you can have, some people have increase or decrease appetite. So some people lose weight, other people gain weight, and insomnia or hypersomnia. So people sleep too much or can't sleep. And you only need 4 out of 9 symptoms to make a diagnosis. So this means that different people with the same diagnosis of depression might be very different. And we don't know if this means that the underlying causes and mechanisms are different. However, to capture this much variety, we need large studies with a lot of people, because it's not a single simple thing. However, MRI are expensive. So in recent, more recent years, researchers started to collaborate and share the data to help neuroscience progress. So there are groups around the world that kind of put together imaging data from worldwide collaboration. And there are some things we can do to keep our mind healthy. Mental health prevention programs focus on preventing development of mental health disorders. And some of the suggested things are things you probably already heard about. One is exercise, and 60 minutes per day is particularly relevant for young people. So not necessarily people like me, I can do a bit less, but for young people, it's recommended 60 minutes a day. And the link between exercise and depression possibly involves a mix of biological and psychological factors. So on one hand, exercise is associated with the release of hormones that makes us feel good, so endorphins, but it also regulates brain chemistry that is linked to depression, so that serotonin that I mentioned earlier. But on the other hand, exercise provides an opportunity for social connection. If you do, for example, exercise with other people, a sense of personal achievement and other positive reinforcement that boosts our mood. Regarding food, we are still trying to understand what is the link between diet and mood. Some research have found that dietary patterns characterized by higher intake of red and processed meat, desserts and refined grain, as opposite to higher intake of vegetables, fruit, lean meat, is associated with higher inflammation in the body, which is in turn associated with increased risk of depression. And sleep, especially during development, is really important because it gives the brain the time to process the experiences that we had during wakefulness. And sleep problems are a very common symptom in depression, and disruption in the circadian rhythm, which is our internal process that regulates the sleep-wake cycle, can lead to mood disturbances. So I think Francis mentioned about, you know, sleeping and disruption in, you know, going to bed very late, waking up not at the normal time. Something that to consider, try to keep what we call sleep hygiene. And if we are feeling depressed, there are things we can do to feel better. Talking with someone you trust, like a family member, a friend or a teacher, is a very good place to begin seeking help. Another place is the family doctor or general practitioners. Family doctors are able to provide information on what's going on, supports that are available, and provide referrals. And there are also online and telehealth options. I've listed some in the next slide, at least for Australia. And if needed, there are effective treatments to help people with experiencing depression. One of the most commonly used is cognitive behavioral therapy, which is based on the idea that moods and emotions are connected with thoughts. So cognitive behavioral therapy explores thinking patterns and how they affect our behavior and emotions. And especially with young people, this type of intervention is a preferred first option rather than medication. So kind of wrapping up, and what is the take-home message? Depression is common, can affect anyone, but especially young people are more at risk. There is no single cause of depression, but it's a combination of factors. And regular exercise, eating well, getting enough sleep, and being connected with friends and family will help us, help our mind staying healthy. And if you or someone else you know is struggling with depressive symptoms, you can seek help. And this is just a list of some resources that are available in Australia. I know they might not be so relevant for people who are not living in Australia, but the websites have also information that can be useful and can be accessed from anywhere. And I hope, I know that some of the answers were not definitive and we still have many questions, but I hope I answer some of yours at least. Thank you very much.
Fantastic. Thank you so much, Dr. Elena Pozzi. That was a really clear and concise, I think, explanation of kind of what depression is, or at least what we do know about it in the current research. And I thought, you know, a few interesting things about, you know, the brain regions involved in depression and stress having overlap there. And so I guess there's indicators there of being able to limit stresses as well. And we do have a bunch of questions that have come through in the chat, okay, which is fantastic. So we'll try and make our way through some of these to start off with. So firstly, we have a question from Radhika, and that's, are all the adverse effects of depression reversible?
Yeah, that's a very good question. We see that there is some, the brain kind of bounces back after depression, especially maybe the first episode the person might have. There is a, what's the word? Yeah, but it's kind of a getting back to kind of the level that it was before having depression.
Okay, thank you. And so I guess kind of leading on to, we've got a couple of questions, I guess, relating to therapeutics or antidepressants. So this is just a bit of an open question, but what is your take on antidepressants?
So I think it depends who is the person that is receiving treatment. I think at least in Australia, especially with young people, the first line of treatment is cognitive behavioral therapy, so behavioral therapy. But in severe cases, antidepressants are definitely an option because you don't want to leave a person with a severe depression in that state for too long. So the antidepressant can really help in severe cases. So if the case is the person is having mild symptoms, I think the guidelines are to try first with behavioral therapy, but then if it's not responsive or if depression is severe, trying antidepressant.
Okay, so I think that actually links into this next question, which you may have answered. So this person is asking about what the treatment, or if there's a superior option for treatment other than antidepressants or cognitive behavioral therapy. But I wonder, is there such an option, or is cognitive behavioral therapy the first kind of step in treatment?
I think it's what is recommended because kind of acts on the symptoms and kind of tries, as I said before, to challenge the thinking and kind of disentangle the relationship between thinking and feelings and behavior and provide like practical strategies. And as is a the efficacy has been supported by clinical trials. So I think that is the, at least in Australia, that is one of the first. I think another one is acceptance. I never remember what the acronym stands for. Acceptance. It's called ACT. The acronym is ACT. I think it's like acceptance cognitive therapy. It's kind of similar in a way. They're kind of related, but it's kind of focuses on accepting our feelings instead of the idea of, oh, we should be happy. If I'm not happy, I'm wrong. Instead of kind of pointing at the fact that it's normal to feel bad sometimes, it's okay, and you don't have to feel ashamed of it or try to hide it. But it's still, I think, kind of similar to cognitive behavior therapy.
Yeah, and I think it's kind of raising the, you know, importance of psychologists or having, I guess, counselling as well, because the cognitive behavioural therapy seems to be quite a big part of that.
Yeah.
And so we do have another question, and I think you touched on it a little bit in your talk about how depression might overlap with other mental illnesses.
Yes, well, especially in young people, very usually what we call comorbidity, so disorder being there at the same time with the anxiety symptoms. Especially in young people, the two can coexist. And sometimes depression can kind of follow another mental health disorder if the person is particularly struggling. For example, schizophrenia, which makes it even harder, right? When we are trying to understand, okay, what happens in the brain, but then it's possible that maybe more than one disorder is occurring. So we think that some of the changes are maybe shared between disorders and some could be unique. So for example, alteration in the amygdala is not necessarily unique of depression. We see it also in anxiety.
Absolutely. And I think that actually links into our next question. So Jaslyn is asking if sex hormones such as testosterone, progesterone, and estrogen can affect the connection between those brain regions you mentioned, between the amygdala and the prefrontal cortex.
Yeah, for sure. Puberty is particularly a time, is an interesting time for mental health. There is some research looking at how maybe people that go into puberty early, so people with kind of a earlier development can be more at risk. We don't know exactly how and why, but definitely they can also play a role.
Amazing, thank you. So just because I'm aware of the time, I might have to select a couple of questions and we may be able to do a follow-up Q&A if we get the time. So Charity has been able to translate one of the questions from the audience. Let me just read this. So what could you say to those individuals who experience symptoms of depression, but think it's only because of their hormones?
I think if the person is concerned, if the person is kind of noticing that, you know, their mood it's kind of down, or all those symptoms we have gone over for, you know, several days, for most of the day, and they have reason to be concerned, I would suggest to seek help. Maybe they can talk with, you know, someone they trust, as I said, it could be, you know, the family doctor, could be even, you know, if it's a young person, could be a teacher or a friend. So not necessarily underestimate if they are concerned. I would encourage them to seek some support. Mm.
Okay, thank you. So we have another question from, I think Ms. Chen Zhen. So why is it that females are more at high risk of experiencing depression than males?
Good question. It could be a bunch of factors. It could be psychological factors, like the way females are brought up in the society, in the sense that, you know, they tend to be more encouraged to kind of spend time on emotions and not pushing emotion away, which is more of a kind of society aspect, but also we think that maybe there are differences in the brain and hormones possibly can also play a role. So we again unfortunately don't have a definite answer, and probably is a combination of both physiological and psychological factors.
Okay, thank you. So yeah, it definitely looks like there's more room for greater research to be done in those areas.
Definitely.
As well.
So hopefully the next generation will come with more ideas and amazing discoveries.
Absolutely. I think that's, I guess, part of the exciting area of neuroscience and neuropsychology as well. So thank you, Dr. Elena. I think I might pass it on to Francis as well, because I see that he's been able to join us, which is really exciting to see. And Frances, I've got a couple of questions for you as well. So when you are ready, and you can unmute yourself as well, I've got one question. Do you know of any psychologists or doctors that help people with depression in Bukidnon?
Actually, at in 18 years here in Bukidnon, I've never know any psychologist or any mental health professionals that helping the youths to conquer this kind of battle. So that's why I'm so eager to promote this kind of topic so that a lot of people could learn about depression or change their understanding about depression, because just like I said on the video, that most of the perspective of people here in Bukidnon, when you met a depressed person, the first thing that came in their mind is that the person is crazy. And if you met a crazy person on the road, you'll freak out or you'll just run away and you're not going to go near or help that person. That's why a lot of people here in Bukidnon is hiding that they are depressed or having mental health issues.
Okay, yeah, thank you for sharing that. And it's definitely something that came up in our conversation about, you know, I guess the limit of mental health support systems that are available, but also the importance that they are really needed. And so I'd also like to ask you about, how do you think we can reduce the stigma or misunderstandings associated with depression?
I also answered this in the video, but I will extend this more. I will use the idea of focus group discussion. In that group, there will be a group of this teenager who's experiencing mental health illness, and there's a professional guiding them. And after they won the battle, we're going to use them as speakers to different symposiums, school by school symposiums. We're going to do that every month so that the information about depression is constant, so that little by little, even it's a baby step, I do believe that things started in small steps and it gets bigger, meaning that even we're just started here in Bukidnon, school by school, day by day, after years will come, the information about depression will change, because a lot of students are learning what is depression is because of these symposiums.
Absolutely. And I think, when you discussed in the video as well about the focus group discussion and having someone who has maybe experienced depression, that it can be a bit different from, you know, maybe talking to someone who doesn't understand, if it is someone who has experienced it. So thank you very much, Frances. I think, you know, we actually do have more questions for Frances and for Dr. Elena, but just noting the time, we probably won't be able to get through them all. However, we might be able to do a follow-up and get the questions answered. We'll see how we go. But thank you everyone for your questions. So next, I definitely would like to get to the resources section to share with everyone. So I guess firstly, we have a selection of resources from Halad to Health. And so what I have here is from our Open Classroom series, and this is available all on our Halad to Health Philippines Facebook page for free, so anyone can access it, and particularly for those joining us from the Philippines and from Bukidnon, make sure to check out our Facebook page. And we've got topics on mental health, adolescent health, such as you can see here, depression, mindfulness, and cyberbullying. In terms of the other resources available in the Philippines, I'd also like to remind everyone that we will be sending a follow-up email, so you don't need to kind of save everything. But I'm really grateful to announce that we have a new resource that we're working to make available in Bukidnon. And so in the last week, our Halad to Health Philippines team have been approached by many local schools in the south who have unfortunately seen an increase in suicide from depression attempts by students who have been struggling to cope in isolation. and to help reach students who need support right now and don't know where to turn, we'll be rolling out a program over the coming weeks that gives any booked non-high school student access to 5 free mental health counseling sessions with professionals from across the island. So this will be completely free. And again, it's fully funded from our GAMSET and Med Interview Services, so as well as donations from events such as tonight. So again, thank you for everyone's support. If this is something you or someone you know could benefit from, I'll leave a link in the chat below and you can register your interest for yourself or for a friend as well. So I'll just do that now. And I think we might just need to move to the next slide so everyone can see the other resources as well. Okay, so just popping in the chat now, and a reminder that we will be sending out a follow-up email, so you don't need to save everything. But just for everyone's reference, so here we have a mental health crisis hotline, as well as there's a support page for anxiety and depression, and that's on Facebook. We'll also go through some resources available in Australia. So again, there's crisis support as well as more general mental health guidance, and I'll also post these in the chat. And there's also a range of mental health and mindfulness apps, which should be accessible from most or any country. So if we just go on to the next slide, we might be able to see those there as well. Fantastic, thank you. So again, these are just an example of sources. It's not an exhaustive list. There's a lot out there, and it's important to find what works for you and what suits your needs. So finally, I guess we'll go to the last slide to do the conclusion. So we hope this event has been, able to better everyone's understanding on depression and mental health. And a really big thank you to our speakers. So to Frances, thank you for your courage in sharing such a personal perspective when it comes to youth depression in the Philippines, and for doing that, you know, preparation beforehand and putting in your time to do that. So thank you so much. And to our keynote speaker, Dr. Elena Pozzi, for delivering a fantastic presentation on what depression is and why it occurs. I know I definitely learned something, and I think, you know, after that talk, I might be able to better explain it to someone else. And I think that's a really useful tool. So thank you. Also, thank you so much to our behind the scenes Halad to Health team. So just a quick shout out to Sarah for doing the tech operations and Charity moderating and live translating on the chat, which is amazing. And also Liza and Will for working so hard to get the Halad to Health mental health services up and running, amongst many other things. So finally, as I conclude the event tonight, we would truly appreciate if you could spare 2 minutes to give us some feedback on the event, as we hope to run even better events in the future. So I'll just pop in the link, and I've also got contact details if you'd like to contact Dr. Elena Pozzi or myself for any further questions or feedback. So hopefully everyone can see that. And then I think we'll just start playing some music to leave everyone to it. Thank you again, and good night. Salamat sa tanan. Thank you. Get Sarah to chuck on her playlist.
Thank you so much, Emma. You've done an amazing job.
All good. No, thank you to everyone's support. I think that's what really made this event happen. So awesome. I might stop recording as well.